Thank you. The next item of business is the debate on motion 11546 in the name of Shona Robinson on fiscal framework review. I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion up to 13 minutes, please. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open today's debate on the revised fiscal framework agreement, and I move the motion in my name. On the 2nd of August, following a joint review, the Scottish and UK governments published an updated version of the Scottish fiscal framework, fulfilling a key commitment in the First Minister's policy prospectus. This government believes that Scotland's future, of course, lies as an independent country, and it would be best served by the full range of fiscal powers and choices that independence would bring. But until such a time as the people of Scotland choose a different constitutional path, we are committed to working with the current framework and working to improve on it. The changes agreed with the UK Government are balanced and pragmatic. This new agreement strengthens the Scottish Government's financial management levers and provides the Scottish Parliament and Government with greater long-term funding certainty. But we need to be clear that despite improvements to the framework, the fiscal position facing the Scottish budget remains extremely difficult. A situation, of course, made worse by decisions imposed by the UK Government in last month's autumn statement. Once again, the UK Government has chosen to pursue an austerity budget that will have a profound consequence for Scotland's public services. As the Institute of Fiscal Studies has said of the autumn statement, the tax cuts are paid for by planned real cuts in public service spending. Even with the fiscal framework in place, levels of funding for the Scottish budget remain closely tied to spending decisions by the UK Government. Decisions to starve services in England hit our budget in Scotland, as the UK Government's failure to invest in services in England means that the devolved administrations in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland do not receive adequate consequentials. A cursory look at the UK Government's autumn statement for 24-25 shows the devastating impact of Tory austerity being forced on services. Even using lower estimates of inflation, UK frontline resource budgets are seeing real terms cuts. For example, if planned UK day-to-day expenditure on services in 2024-25 had grown in real terms since 22-23, then compared to Conservative plans in England, health and social care spending would be over £8 billion higher. The UK Government's approach means that it has provided almost no funding to cover the costs of this year's pay deal in 2023-24, never mind the cost of a 2024-25 pay deal. The lack of provision for the cost of NHS pay deals amounts to treating pay increases as though they were one-off costs, which of course they are not. Prior to tax and welfare block grant adjustments, Scotland's resource budget from the UK Government in 2024-25 will be over £700 million lower than if there had been funding in line with real terms over the 2 years. Changes to the fiscal framework cannot compensate for the scale of the UK Government's failure to act and invest in public services at this time. So, returning to the fiscal framework review, while the revised agreement has delivered important improvements, I want to be clear that the Scottish Government's preference would have been for a review that was broader in scope, and that in some places the agreement does not go as far as we would have wished. The scope of the review and its outcome was, of course, subject to agreement with the UK Government. I also want to address the timing of this agreement. Throughout discussions with the UK Government on arrangements for the review, my predecessors and I have sought to balance the need to keep Parliament informed with the need to maintain a confidential space for negotiations. In weighing whether to conclude an agreement during recess, I had to consider the benefits of securing improved borrowing powers in advance of the 2024-25 budget, and that we were negotiating with a UK Government that will probably go into election mode soon. Considering these circumstances, I concluded that it was appropriate and prudent to agree the revised agreement when the opportunity arose. The Scottish fiscal framework plays a central role in determining the funding for the Scottish budget and has been key to enabling the devolution of new tax and social security powers provided for in the 2016 Scotland Act. The original fiscal framework was agreed in 2016 and was the product of negotiations between the Scottish and UK governments. These negotiations were, of course, guided by the principles and recommendations articulated by the Cross-Party Smith Commission, which published its findings in 2014. And that remains the case for this revised agreement. The Barnett formula continues as the basis for calculating the block grant, and the framework continues to be bounded by the principles outlined by the Smith Commission. Those include principles of economic responsibility, sustainability and no detriment as a result of devolution. Since 2016, the Scottish Government has used the tax and social security powers underpinned by the framework to pursue policies better tailored to Scotland's needs. For example, the Scottish Government has delivered the fairest and most progressive income tax system in the UK while raising extra revenue to invest in public services and Scotland's economy. And with devolved social security powers, the Scottish Government has ensured additional support to the most vulnerable in our society. Yes.
Liz Smith.
I'm grateful to her for giving way. In light of the point she's just made, does she believe that there is a case for the principles of the Smith Commission to be looked at again in light of the time that has elapsed since? Or does she think that these are the correct principles to underpin future fiscal frameworks?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm open to having that discussion. I think Liz Smith made this point at committee, and I said that a lot of time has elapsed, a lot of changes have been made, and if we're talking about under the current constitutional arrangements, then clearly those would need to be agreed on a cross-party basis, but I think it's a discussion that we should have. Since the unanimous passing of the Social Security Act in 2018, we have introduced 13 benefits, seven of which are brand new and only available in Scotland. This year, we will invest £405 million in the Scottish Child Payment, improving the lives of over 300,000 children across Scotland. And as a result of the Scottish Child Payment and Scottish Government policies, 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year. However, it's also the case that the fiscal framework has been stress-tested since 2016. The agreement preceded the EU referendum and subsequent chaos and uncertainty that accompanied the UK government's hard Brexit. And we have, of course, seen extraordinary fiscal upheaval as a result of the pandemic, the ongoing cost of living crisis, and the UK government's economic mismanagement. And given this political and fiscal upheaval, the review provided an opportunity to take stock and consider elements of the fiscal framework that required change. The centrepiece of the agreement in 2016 was the block grant adjustment arrangements that account for the devolution of new tax powers and social expenditure to Scotland. Under these arrangements, a total of £16.1 billion was deducted from the Scottish block grant in the 2023-24 budget to reflect the devolution of various tax powers and the corresponding revenues now retained by the Scottish Government. Similarly, £4.4 billion was added to the block grant for 2023-24 to reflect the transfer of responsibility for a suite of social security benefits to the Scottish Parliament. The methodology used to calculate these block grant adjustments therefore had a material impact on the funding available for the Scottish budget. Securing the index per capita block grant adjustment methodology on a permanent basis is a significant win for Scotland. The Scottish Government pressed hard for the index per capita methodology as part of the original fiscal framework. And the 2016 fiscal framework said that the index per capita methodology would apply on an interim basis with a permanent arrangement to be reviewed and agreed at a later date. Having now completed that review, the agreement to apply the index per capita methodology on a permanent basis is a positive step because it removes uncertainty and protects the Scottish budget from the impact of slower population growth in Scotland, which has been the historic trend over the past 50 years. An independent report jointly commissioned by the Scottish and UK governments ahead of the fiscal framework review estimated that the ongoing use of the index per capita methodology for calculating income tax block grant adjustments alone could be worth around £500 million a year by 2026-27 when compared with other methodologies that were considered, such as the Treasury's preferred comparable model. In my view, it's right to protect the Scottish budget in this way. The Scottish budget should not be penalised for lower population growth, which of course is out with Scotland's control because we don't have the key levers over things like migration and other levers that would be required. The agreement also provides a substantial increase in the Scottish Government's resource borrowing powers to manage funding volatility associated with the operation of the framework. Specifically, it increases the Scottish Government's ability to borrow to address tax and social security forecast errors, doubling from £300 to £600 million per year of borrowing capacity. These forecast errors are a normal part of the way the fiscal framework operates, but this change greatly improves the Scottish Government's ability to manage and smooth funding volatility driven by forecast error. This in turn will provide a more stable and predictable funding environment for the Scottish Budget and the programmes and services that it supports. These new borrowing powers will take effect from 2024-25. I will set out how we intend to use these powers at the forthcoming budget, but in principle, these new powers would allow us to borrow in full to cover next year's income tax and other reconciliations, which amount to £338 million. The ability to borrow in full effectively spreads the impact of the tax reconciliations across multiple years, rather than requiring that that cost is absorbed in a single budget. Another important development involves changes to the operation of the Scotland Reserve. Alongside borrowing powers, the Scotland Reserve provides the Scottish Government flexibility to manage its funding position across financial years and to respond to unforeseen circumstances. However, the Scottish Government's ability to draw funds from the Reserve was previously constrained. They were limited to a maximum of £100 million for capital and £250 million for resource funding. That amounts to around 1.5% of the total Scottish capital budget in 23-24 and 0.5% of the resource budget. I'm pleased to report that this new agreement sees those drawdown limits removed altogether, significantly increasing reserve flexibility and the Scottish Government's ability to manage funding across financial years. As you would expect, specific decisions on the use and application of these bolstered powers will be outlined as part of the Scottish Budget. More broadly, we have also agreed that in future, all borrowing and reserve limits will grow with inflation each year. Previously, annual and cumulative limits for borrowing and reserve limits had been set in nominal terms, eroding their power and effectiveness over time with inflation. So securing uprating ensures that the powers continue to be viable and sustainable and that limits are protected in real terms. In keeping with this approach and recognising how circumstances have changed since the fiscal framework was introduced in 2016, we've agreed to increase the baseline adjustment to the block grant, which accompanied the devolution of responsibility for managing Crown estate assets. This adjustment will increase in increments reaching £40 million in 28-29, where it will remain fixed in nominal terms. To avoid any further delays in the Scottish and UK Government's concluding of the revised agreement, it was jointly decided that arrangements for implementing VAT assignment would be further considered at a future meeting of the Joint Exchequer Committee. And I very much appreciate the work that the Finance Committee has put into looking at that matter. Viewed in the round, this agreement protects funding for the Scottish Budget, updates the framework to reflect changes since 2016, provides greater certainty on future funding and equips the Scottish Government with a set of strengthened fiscal levers. But as I said, while the revised fiscal framework agreement represents good progress and puts in place arrangements that better reflect the scale and complexity of the Scottish Budget, the changes are not on a scale required to offset the broader fiscal challenge. At the autumn statement, the Chancellor failed to provide the funding that devolved governments need, with little consideration of Scotland and the specific challenges we face. That will be very challenging indeed, and I will set out the consequences of that at the budget on the 19th of December. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Liz Smith to speak to and to move Amendment 11546.4. Up to 9 minutes, please, Liz Smith.
Thank you. And before I do so, Presiding Officer, can I apologise on behalf of my colleague, Murdo Fraser, who is indisposed this afternoon, having fallen on the ice this morning, and I understand that's the case for other colleagues across the chamber. So can I both extend the apology and wish them well in their recovery? I'm afraid the chamber will have to listen to me twice today, as I will step into the role of summing up. So mention the fiscal framework, and you can pretty much guarantee that a glazed look comes across the face of colleagues and journalists alike, such as its intense complexity and technical nature. But it matters hugely for the reasons that the Cabinet Secretary has set out. And that's not just because of the importance to Scotland's available finances, but also with regard for the need for Westminster and Holyrood to work together to get the best deal for Scotland, because I believe that's exactly what the public wants, and I also believe that that is what they deserve. And whilst we can obviously see yet again from the government's motion and from what the Cabinet Secretary said in her speech, they don't really like the fiscal framework on the basis that they wish it wasn't necessary, because they obviously prefer different constitutional arrangements to the rest of us. But both John Swinney in 2016 and now Shona Robson in 2023 have rightly accepted that under the current constitutional arrangements, they have a duty, and it is a duty, to ensure that Scotland gets the best deal. And that's because it is vitally important that both governments do everything that they can to protect the Scottish finance, particularly in these tough economic times. And I have to say that I think that the new framework, which was signed on the 2nd of August, will do exactly that in a way that is better than the 2016 model, which, despite the fact that most economists believed it served Scotland pretty well, it was clearly out of date, particularly as a result of inflationary pressures. Now, the new model is better because it is GDP deflator protected, because it has provided greater flexibility to the Scottish Government on existing borrowing power, and it has obviously taken into account the damaging consequences of exogenous shocks to the system. Now, that's all changes that the Scottish Government, in my opinion, was rightly calling for, and so it's good to see that these changes have been made. Of course.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for giving way. I just wonder if she could perhaps develop the argument about whether the revised fiscal framework adequately provides for the scale of financial shocks that we are experiencing, because the Finance Secretary is having to wrestle with very significant levels of inflation, which we have not experienced for about 45, 50 years. But the crucial lack of response in the autumn statement demonstrates that the fiscal framework can provide all the rules it wants if the underlying financial position, as demonstrated by the autumn statement, is not sufficient to support public expenditure. Public services in Scotland will feel the pressure as a consequence of Westminster decision making.
Liz Smith.
Tony is making a constitutional point, and we disagree on these constitutional arrangements. So when it comes to exogenous shocks, it's not just questions about the current economic circumstances, it's the conditions of the COVID pandemic, which other countries have obviously suffered on exactly the same basis as us. So we will have our constitutional debates, but I really don't think that in this particular debate, which actually I think there was a case to be made that it should have been a committee debate, because it is about the fiscal framework, which the member himself signed in 2016, and now his colleague has signed it in 2023. And I think these are very important aspects of how we try to ensure, under the current constitutional arrangements, how we move forward together.
I can give you a wee bit of time back. John Swinney.
I'm very grateful to Liz Smith for giving me, because I'm not actually making a constitutional point. I'm making a point about the substance of the autumn statement, because the substance of the autumn statement fuels, in general, the size of the public finances available to the Scottish Government to deploy. And the point I'm making is that the failure of the Conservative Government to take adequate account in the autumn statement of the enormous effects of inflation will have a profound and unavoidable effect on the pressures on public finances and public services here in Scotland. That's nothing to do with the Constitution. That's the existing arrangements just now. It's the policy choices of the Conservative Government.
But Elizabeth. But
Mr Swinney has made exactly these points when he was Finance Secretary himself. It's not just talking about this current autumn statement. Mr Swinney would have been making these statements about previous budgets. And it is a constitutional point, because he fundamentally disagrees with the arrangements about how Scotland receives its money. That's the constitutional difference, and it's not just, as I say, this autumn statement that he has objected to. There are previous ones in the past where he has made his point very strongly known in this chamber. Now, I do think that the Deputy First Minister was right when she said that any fiscal framework requires serious negotiation and an understanding from both governments that compromise will be necessary, and that, Presiding Officer, I think that's very much what we actually got. And I'm sure that what local government would like to see is that same process of mutual engagement and understanding when it comes to the Verity House Agreement, which took such a knock 2 months ago when the council tax freeze was announced without any consultation. And that's a point, I think, very well made by the Liberal amendment. But as well as this, what really matters is this debate about the principles of the Smith Commission, particularly when it comes to the no detriment clause. Now, that's a very technical argument, but I think it really does matter, and I'm glad to hear the Cabinet Secretary say that she thinks that might be worthy of debate, because it is very difficult, as was evidenced by the three Davids, the Iser, Phillips and Bell independent report, who make it very clear that while all these principles have very good intentions, it is exceptionally difficult, if not impossible, to actually ensure that they can be followed all at the same time. And I just wonder if, given the time that has elapsed, we should be thinking about whether we have to update that Smith Commission. And I think the Finance Committee is quite interested in that as well. Of course.
Chairman McMillan.
Thank Liz Smith for taking the intervention. Is she suggesting that Section 18 of the Smith Commission should also be up for review?
No, I'm talking very specifically about the principles, the four principles, and given the difficulty that have been identified by independent analysis, not by politicians, whether it is possible to go along with all these four principles at the same time. That's the difficulty, and I think that's something that the Finance Committee has to review. And of course, that then raises this issue that the Cabinet Secretary referred to about the BGA methodology, because that matters too. And, you know, if we get a glazed look about mentioning the fiscal framework, we get a sense of unintelligibility when it comes to talking about BGAs, but they matter as well. And I think the dilemma that is at the heart of any fiscal framework negotiation is exactly that. Because how do you measure the change in equivalent UK spending and revenues in terms of adjustments that need to be made for different fiscal and demographic structures in Scotland? Is it 9 minutes I have?
Yes, I can give you perhaps another minute and a half in light of the generosity of your interventions, thank you.
Thank you very much. I just want to say something about the fact that I think we owe the officials, both in the Scottish Government and the UK Government, our praise and congratulations for the way that they went about this renegotiation. I think they worked extraordinarily hard on what are immensely difficult technical changes, and I know the Cabinet Secretary was commending the officials when she came to committee, and also, give her due, she was commending her UK colleague John Glenn at the time, and I know that was reciprocated by him. So I'll come back to a few other comments in my summing up, but these are the points I think are most important when it comes to assessing the fiscal framework, and I think we've got a big debate ahead of us in exactly how we take that forward. And I will move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Smith. And I now call on Michael Marra to speak to and to move Amendment 11546.3. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Marra.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. Can I begin by adding my own thanks and those of Scottish Labour to those given by Liz Smith to officials and the experts involved in what is a complex piece of work that has developed, I think, over a very long period of time, longer than many of us might have expected. And I would have hoped that this afternoon's debate could have been an opportunity for a full exploration for a substantive debate in reality of the structure and detail of the outcome of that fiscal framework review, but what the government sought to achieve in those negotiations and why, what compromises were reached, the upsides and the limitations, why index per capita was preferable to the comparable method and other options that were on the table, and what I think crucially the government and the parliament might seek in future developments and the timeframes for future review. But instead, the motion that we have before us quickly dispatches with cooperation and negotiation in urgent search of further division. And while some of those concerns are certainly merited, the tone so far from parts of the Deputy First Minister's speech of blame shifting are of the type that has come to typify an administration desperately trying to distract and deflect from its own sorry mess. Not at the moment, I'm just beginning, sir. Nowhere was that more apparent, I'm afraid to say, than in the government's reality-denying post-truth response to the damning PISA figures released yesterday, Scotland's once mighty education system continuing a 16-year trend of SNP-led decline. The government's response, nothing to see here. And meanwhile, a generation of Scots are betrayed by what is a shambolic government that has failed to deliver the education system they deserve, or even to preserve the one they once had, and it is utterly shameful. So if the government is keen to discuss the real context of the fiscal framework review rather than the content of the review itself, so be it, because that context is certainly illuminating after all. That projected £1 billion funding gap for the upcoming budget between the government's spending pledges and the funds that it has available, that figure rising to £1.9 billion by 2027-28. And a large portion of that budget is determined by income tax receipts raised right here in Scotland. And the utter failure of the government to grow the Scottish economy results in the stagnant low investment economy that the SNP is holding Scotland back within. And such a performance means that our fiscal position suffers year on year. And for that, they must accept responsibility. Faced with a budget black hole, we have a finance secretary who has embraced the Treasury on those limited borrowing powers that she describes, desperate to conclude an agreement and happy to sacrifice the long-term good for the short-term good of the party.
Will the member give way?
Certainly.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. Will he be committing the Labour Party to renegotiating the fiscal framework if Labour were to win the next election?
Mike O'Mara.
We're all committed to a continual development in the fiscal framework. There will be reviews in future terms. And of course, just as over since 1997, the devolution settlement has evolved significantly with ever more powers arriving in this Parliament. I certainly anticipate that the settlement will continue to evolve in future years. We will look at the fiscal framework as those issues develop. It would only be right to do so, and we've heard in the Finance Committee that is part of the process to which we are all committed. So, no, thank you, not on that point. So, the hasty agreement that was struck by the Finance Secretary it was, frankly, one of a government that is rushing from one part of crisis to the next. The rushed process has, frankly, shut down any real opportunity for genuine debate or robust scrutiny of the substance of this itself. Professor David Bell, no thank you, sir. Professor David Bell, one of the three authors of the independent report, told the Finance Committee on 19 September that he was surprised that their report was held back for 5 months, before being published on the same day as the finalised fiscal framework and a fait accompli was arrived at. This should have been a genuine opportunity for broad discussion. And then it was all rushed out the door during the summer recess. The government tried to schedule this debate in September before the Finance and Administration, Public Administration Committee had even had the opportunity to take evidence on the updated agreement. So today's debate, a little over 2 hours, but back in September we did have longer than that, debating the many merits of football. I think our nation's finances deserve perhaps a little longer. Parliament exists to spend more time, to be frank, on these matters which will impact every single citizen and those citizens as yet unborn. So why is this government so desperate to avoid the genuine scrutiny that Labour would like to see? Deleting WhatsApps, forgetting meetings, refusing to reform FOI, even today suing the Information Commissioner. Because the Deputy First Minister told the Finance and Public Administration Committee that she did not think there would be a public debate over the fiscal framework because it is, I quote, quite technical. Well, I find that quite astonishing. Like so much in the SNP's tenure, NHS waiting list, school attainment, this has been filed in the a little bit too difficult pile. Granted, it's not the instant vote winner, tax freezes, free bikes and laptops, but good government, in the best interest of the people of Scotland, rests on getting the quite technical issues right. No, thank you. This updated fiscal framework gives Scotland more borrowing powers, and the SNP frequently claim that they're powerless in this Parliament to deal with the situation that they find themselves in. Let's be clear, the Tories have wreaked economic havoc on this country, for which we all pay the price every day in higher bills and falling living standards. But the SNP have a very strong hand in making much of the fiscal mess that they find themselves in at the moment. And they do have tools at their disposal to do something about it. Certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm just giving it that litany of accusations. What he would say to his Welsh Labour government colleagues who are facing exactly the same challenges, would he make the same accusations of them when they sit in the same room making the same points as I do to the Treasury, that the problems emanate from the UK government, the lack of fiscal powers and an autumn statement that's going to lead to really difficult decisions with public services?
Michael Marr.
I do not have any doubt that this, and I've said very clearly, as the Labour Party has, that there are significant problems with the autumn statement, the situation that the Tory government has left this country in, the state that they have made of our economy, the fact that they are not funding sufficiently our public services. Labour, if we have the great joy and the opportunity to serve in years to come, we'll have to deal with the situation that we find if we are to take government. We know that there are difficult times ahead in that regard, and we know that the Finance Secretary has a difficult job on her hands to deal with the budget that's in front of her. But she also knows that the situation this country finds itself in is because their failure to grow the economy, to grow that median tax income, to grow the tax receipts that fund our public services. That is the only way that we can substantively deal with the situation that faces us. So these are not the actions of a competent government that we're hearing about today. It's thinking strategically about how to best serve the people of Scotland. Rather, they are, presiding officer, the actions of a government that is in crisis, it's out of its depth, it's making it up as it goes along. It's caught in a maelstrom of its own scandals, gaffes and controversies, and Scotland deserves far better than this.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak to and to move Amendment 11546.2. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to rise for the Liberal Democrats in this debate, and I move the amendment in my name. Presiding Officer, the fiscal framework is, of course, key to the pooling and sharing of resources across our islands, ensuring that Scotland benefits from the decisions that we make, while being protected by a framework of support from the UK government in the good times and at the times of national crisis. What we are talking about today is more flexibility than ever, more power than ever, but that won't stop the SNP, as we've already heard, blaming Westminster more than ever. And listening to ministers, you wouldn't know that we've seen income tax devolved, the way opened to a £4 billion social security system, or any of the other positive changes that make this fiscal framework a necessity. I'm glad agreement could be reached on changes such as increasing the resource and capital borrowing capacity, but Scotland deserves two governments that have a genuine interest in working together to make devolution work as it should, as it can. Resolving differences maturely should be the norm, not a rarity. There should be a shared interest in its success. There is little spirit of cooperation and partnership on show in either the SNP or Conservative contributions to this debate. And the Scottish Government would rather debate powers that it doesn't have than make best use of the powers that we already do have. Don't get me wrong, I am happy to agree with the Deputy First Minister that there was little worth welcoming in the UK Government's autumn statement. NHS budget squeezed. A giveaway to big banks that will cost billions of pounds to the Treasury, prioritising their profits over making working families better off. I sincerely hope that it will be the Conservatives' very last autumn statement. But there's no escaping the fact that the SNP government have been writing cheques that people simply can't cash. They have had their fingers in their ears only to take them out to point at Westminster. Take the devolution of Social Security, a crucial component of why we need a fiscal framework. We've seen the latest independence paper just published today. And what's not in there is mention of the agency agreement Scottish ministers have with the Department for Work and Pensions. Powers that we all agreed should be devolved back in 2014 are still not there because Scottish ministers still aren't ready to receive them and are asking the DWP to run it for them. I know ministers will say some benefits have already been devolved, and that is certainly true. But look at what's happening there. We have seen reports that waiting times for Social Security Scotland are in the region, in some cases, of 4 to 7 months for a decision on adult disability payment. That compares to 2 or 3 months under the DUP in London. It's worse. Applicants have spoken about waiting on the phone for up to 3 hours and more before giving up. They were promised a better system, a system steeped in dignity, as a system we all rallied behind. And remember, the SNP want us to believe that it could set up an independent Scotland welfare system in its totality, pensions and all, in just 18 months. Presiding officer, it's taken more than a year to devolve 11 simple benefits. People were promised a better system in 2014. It's just not good enough. But this government would rather debate powers than make best use of the ones that we already have. Behind the lazy cry for the breakup of the United Kingdom and the Scottish Government's motion, you will find years of warnings from experts that went unheeded. Take, for example, the Auditor General, who was warning at least as far back as 2018 that the NHS was not in a financially sustainable position, that now Scotland's health boards are forecasting a deficit of £395 million this year. The problems have been allowed to stack up, and people will be worried that this dire outlook will mean cuts to services and even longer waits to patients waiting in pain. And remember, of course, the words of Professor Paul Gray, the chief executive of NHS Scotland for 6 years under Nicola Sturgeon, who said, and I quote, "The current system was going to be overwhelmed, regardless of COVID. The virus simply brought the date of that event forward." Then, of course, there was the Christie Commission back in 2011, warning about the need to increase preventative spending to stop demand swamping public service capacity. But we have seen cuts from mental health and drugs budgets that fly in the face of that reform agenda. This government would rather debate powers than make the best use of the ones that we already have. Presiding officer, the amendment in my name speaks to the ever more precarious position that Scottish councils are in. We've just seen council leaders warning that local authorities are at risk of bankruptcy, and that essential services, in their words, will cease. Game over. Councils need a fiscal framework that respects and recognises the important work that they do, the freedoms they need to innovate, and their need for a fair share of Scottish Government resources. But this government, just in the recent months, drove a coach and horses through that very fiscal framework in the shape of the Verity House Agreement. Because when councils are squeezed to the pips, education gets squeezed to the pips as well. And you don't need to look very far, Presiding Officer, than yesterday's PISA figures, which Michael Marra rightly referred to in his remarks, as an insight into the impact of this Scottish Government's cuts. I will speak more of that in my closing remarks, but for now, Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. And I now call on Ash Regan to speak to and to move Amendment 11546.1. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am pleased to move the ALBA Party amendment to this motion today. So the fiscal framework, as we've been discussing, is complicated, but I believe it's deliberately complicated. It's the formula, obviously, for determining Scotland's funding as part of the UK via the block grant, the Barnett formula, minus the abatements or deductions. Scotland is rewarded if we can grow our economy faster than the UK, and then punished if we don't. But no region of the UK other than London and the South East ever ends up with higher GDP rises than the UK average. So the additional clause was added to the Smith Commission report, the no detriment clause, which we've been discussing already this afternoon. And this was meant to recognise the fact that for the most part, Scotland's economic performance has a lot more to do with reserved UK economic policy than it does with anything that we do here at Holyrood. And of course, we recently witnessed firsthand during the time of the pandemic why we need that full fiscal autonomy, because much of the financial support that the Scottish Government could provide to back up the public health policy could only be delivered if the UK government decided that those were also the priorities in England. So in my opinion, the no detriment provisions do not deliver as perhaps they might do for Scotland. And rather than the Smith Commission delivering greater fiscal control and responsibility for Scotland, it has unfortunately left us with a position of having greater accountability, but crucially without the fiscal levers to back it up. Greater responsibility without power. Never a good position to be in. In recent years, the Scottish Government has chosen to increase tax slightly. And this should mean more money raised to spend on investing in better public services, something I think we would all welcome, and I'm sure the Scottish public would welcome very much. But this is not what happened. The Spice report, the Scottish public paid £900 million in higher tax over a three-year period, but the Scottish budget only rose by £170 million over that same period. So £730 million was lost because of the fiscal settlement. And that would be enough, of course, to raise the Scottish child payment to £40 a week several times over. So Scotland is in the unfortunate position of raising tax in order to fill a black hole in the block grant created by the fiscal framework. I'll give way.
Michael Murrough.
I wonder if the member could tell us when she was a minister in the government whether she expressed any scepticism to her colleagues as to whether those tax positions were the right approach to take given the consequences.
Ashley.
The member may not remember this, but I was actually in the Justice Department and I certainly did have conversations with colleagues, but particularly about funding settlements for justice. I wasn't obviously responsible for financial decisions made on a broader scale than that. My opinion is that this is not a good deal for Scotland, and the new fiscal framework is worse still. I believe it's a trap. I think it's an economic trap. I think it's a political trap that the Scottish Government have acceded to either knowingly or unknowingly. The fiscal framework is, of course, a means of forcing the Scottish Government to pursue a low-tax, small-state approach to government, and this is against the values of the Scottish Government and, of course, the majority of Scots who elected that government. And also, it also has the real danger of relative economic decline built into it as well. Now, separating what economic impacts come from UK policy and what are actually from policy created in this Parliament is almost now an impossible task, which has been alluded to earlier in the debate. But this new deal seems to have accepted that it is just too difficult. And so, as a result, Scotland just accepts that it's going to be responsible for both. Disastrous economic choices that are made in London are heaping misery onto a Scotland that is in a position of just running to stand still against things like soaring inflation and Brexit carnage. Dr. Jim Cuthbert, formerly of the Scottish Office, explains that it's nigh on impossible for the Scottish Government to develop a successful fiscal policy under this arrangement. So it's very easy to see why the Conservatives are happy with this settlement. I don't think they should be, by the way. I think it harms their constituents as much as it harms my constituents. But what's less easy to understand is why the Scottish Government has agreed to it. Is it really in the best interests of Scotland, or is it in fact damaging? One reason that I believe it is damaging is it is forcing Scotland into suboptimal decisions on capital spending. This is just one example. And this would be the poor value PPP, which is a model of financing public sector infrastructure that the UK has now moved away from because they can. But Scotland can't because our choices are very limited. I'm concluding now, I'm afraid. Presiding Officer, it's only clear that devolution can only deliver to us so much. And it is the powers of independence that will enable Scotland to create a thriving economy, a wealthier nation, and higher living standards for all of us.
Thank you, Ms Regan. And I now call on Kenneth Gibson to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, and will focus on the Fiscal Framework Review, an area of interest to the Committee since the start of Session 6. We provided a consultation response to the independent report authors and expected to be given an opportunity to contribute to the review as originally agreed by the UK and Scottish Governments in 2021. As we now know, the review was much narrower in scope and the outcome unexpectedly announced in August 2023. The speed with which the review was agreed came as a surprise to both the committee and those stakeholders we took evidence from last month. As the Deputy First Minister explained, a narrow window of opportunity for the review emerged and the UK Government did not favour widening its scope. In addition, the possibility of an imminent change of Treasury Minister meant the Scottish Government had to grab the opportunity to secure what improvements it could to the existing fiscal framework. Unfortunately, we have not been able to explore the UK Government's perspective on the negotiations. The Chancellor of the Exchequer, like his three predecessors, admittedly two of them were very short-lived, has not responded to our invitations to engage or give evidence to the committee. The former Chief Secretary of the Treasury also declined those invitations, despite his stated keenness to work with the devolved parliaments. This approach by Treasury is very unhelpful, and one I know that committee colleagues are also keen to see greater engagement with. Turning to the outcome of the review, the updated framework confirms that the index per capita method will continue to be used to adjust the block grant rather than a comparable method. This was a key gain for the Scottish Parliament in 2016 following tough negotiations conducted by then First Minister Nicola Sturgeon and Deputy First Minister John Swinney, who dug their heels in after months of discussion. It meant that the Scottish budget will benefit by millions of pounds each year because the index per capita method takes account of the fact that Scotland had, at the point of income tax devolution, lower income tax capacity than the rest of the UK. Also takes account of the potential differential population growth between Scotland and the rest of the UK. In the updated framework, borrowing for capital expenditure will be linked to inflation so that the limits increase, but it will increase according to the GDP deflator. This is very positive overall, given that the value of resource and capital borrowing has been fixed since it was first published alongside the Scotland Act 2016, despite inflation having risen by over 30% since, eroding the spending power constrained by those limits. However, the committee was surprised to see the Fraser Valder's estimate of borrowing growth over the next 4 years will only be a cumulative 5.5%. As capital inflation is outstripping GDP deflator inflation, this is a wholly unrealistic measure. Looking at capital inflation specifically would be more accurate and helpful. Witnesses suggested to the committee that this may be one area where the Scottish Government had to compromise to reach agreement. And of course, there was a negotiation between two parties who were not equal in terms of ultimately who could decide the outcome. As the Deputy First Minister explained to us, using the GDP deflator was the only option on the table. And as my dear old late mum said, half a loaf is better than no bread. So this limited gain is important to Scotland. Resource borrowing limits remain at £1.75 billion, but will now rise with the GDP deflator. Capital borrowing limits are £450 million annually, with a total limit of £3 billion, both of which are now index-linked to the GDP deflator. It's disappointing that prudential borrowing, which would provide greater flexibility and is available to Scotland's local authorities, is not available to the Scottish Government, which would provide it with better ways of being able to deal with and balance its budget. In relation to the annual borrowing powers, the updated fiscal framework increases limits from £300 million to £600 million a year, which is again welcome to meet forecast errors, and this is also index-linked from next year. And this is particularly helpful given that next year there will be a large negative reconciliation of £390 million to reflect income tax receipts in 21-22. That said, as witnesses advise, modelling with the Scottish Fiscal Commission means that forecast error could still potentially exceed this limit once or twice every decade, so those challenges remain. With the increase in annual borrowing limits, the updated fiscal framework no longer provides any additional borrowing for a Scottish economic shock. As members would recall previously, the economic shock provisions were provided in order to respond to forecast error rather than managing changes in resource spending. The updated fiscal framework also defers a decision on VAT assignment in Scotland to a future Joint Exchequer Committee meeting. At the committee's roundtable discussion on VAT assignment last month, the clear and unanimous consensus is that there is no form of VAT assignment from Westminster to Holyrood that could address the significant uncertainty and volatility it poses to the Scottish budget. This is despite the best efforts of officials over many years to explore how that methodology might work. The significant issues that remain include that there will never be any reconciliation to actual Scottish VAT receipts, and the income from VAT receipts in the UK can be significantly revised retrospectively over a number of years. And it will not be possible to directly link the Scottish Government's actions on the economy to subsequent changes in VAT receipts. Without policy control over setting VAT, assignment would be all risk and no reward. As such, we believe the Joint Exchequer Committee should stop exploring the current VAT assignment methodology. And we welcome the Deputy First Minister's commitment to keep informed of these discussions. Presiding Officer, the updated fiscal framework states it will be reviewed periodically on a five-yearly basis, but not more than once in any Scottish or UK electoral cycle. With a UK general election on the horizon, the Deputy First Minister advised the committee that the framework has a number of asks of any incoming UK government, and we are mindful of the experience of the Barnett formula, which was a temporary measure first introduced in 1973. As such, we seek assurances from the Scottish Government that a key ask of the next UK government will be that the next fiscal framework review is significantly more substantial, while enabling this Parliament and stakeholders to actively participate in the review process. And as that process this year concluded, I wish again to thank all the officials who have participated and helped ministers both north and south of the border in providing the updated fiscal framework review, which is beneficial to Scotland, although not as beneficial as we would like to see.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. We will now move to the open debate. I would advise members that we have no time in hand, and therefore any interventions taken, the time must be absorbed within the member's own speaking allocation, which is up to 6 minutes. And with that, I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Brian Whittle. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, starting at the beginning, there's much commentary during the COVID crisis that some of the lending being made available was merely propping up zombie businesses. What do we mean by zombie businesses, Presiding Officer? Now, Investopedia defines them as, and I quote, "Zombies are countries that earn just enough money to continue operating and service debt, have no excess capital to invest to spur growth, are typically subject to higher borrowing costs, and may be just one event away from a bailout." Yes, I did say country rather than company deliberately, for that's the UK today, a zombie country. The UK that had the slowest recovery of all of the large advanced economies from the pandemic. The UK where growth lagged behind the average for both large and small advanced economies for the 40 years even before the pandemic. The UK that only today was ranked last in UNICEF's table of child poverty, with the worst rise in child poverty between 2012 and 2019 out of the 39 world's richest countries. Thank goodness for the Scottish Child Payment. The UK, with government debt equivalent to 97.8% of GDP at the end of October 2023. Economically, the UK is not OK, and anyone who says otherwise is either a fool or utterly disingenuous. Now, I was personally wary about participating in this debate and shrinking my thinking to the tinkering with a fiscal framework, a framework designed to ensure heads, the UK Treasury wins, and tails, the UK Treasury wins. I think the amendments to the motion are mostly ridiculous and show the paucity of vision encapsulated in the zombie deniers seated opposite. The vast majority of monetary and fiscal policy resides with Westminster, and it's this macroeconomic framing that we must not forget. I intend to focus my remarks today on the limitations for capital expenditure and the lack of prudential borrowing powers. Capital expenditure is a vital tool. Infrastructure development creates jobs, improves productivity, brings longer-term economic benefits, has a multiplier effect, and is typically and normally used to encourage growth. So instead of looking down the barrel of a 7% cut over the next few years, the capital borrowing amounts have been retained with a mechanism to uprate by inflation, but tied to a GDP deflator, which is nowhere near inflation. And the Deputy First Minister noted to the Finance Committee that, and I quote, "The biggest challenge that we face comes from capital borrowing limits. We got as much as we could achieve, but we're not able to expand the basket of measures that were being looked at." Now, interestingly, the comments of the DFM were followed by one of our officials who explained the Treasury viewed that as a zero-sum thing, as anything that it gave us would be a loss to its fiscal position. And that's a working example of no detriment. This comment, more than anything, explains my opening remarks of why the UK is a zombie country and we're locked in to low growth. Now, we can't look forward to a change from the Labour Party either. Sir Keir Starmer's clearly indicated his intention to follow the exact same macroeconomic policies that have led us to this point. This then leads us to alternatives. Now, I'm grateful for the report that Jim Cuthbert wrote for Commonweal and sent to the Finance Committee. In it, he reminded us that PPP schemes and their variants, such as PPI, were enthusiastically used by Tory and Labour alike. He also reminded us of the frankly staggering cost to the public purse, the lack of value, and of the conclusion reached by the House of Commons Public Audits Committee that said, Treasury cannot provide evidence to support its claims that PFI is worthwhile for any reason apart from the fact that it takes debt off the balance sheet. Now, of course, the UK government's now retreated from the use of these schemes, but leaving both Scotland and Wales able to use more modern, yet still expensive variants, such as a mutual investment model, instead of proper capital borrowing powers. Presiding Officer, I conclude with this final remark. The convener of the Finance Committee noted how ridiculous it was that local councils can access prudential lending, but not the Scottish Government, despite that being part of the Smith Commission recommendations. I agree. Regrettably, that wasn't on the table, presumably because it might have brought some significant benefit to the people of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. And I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by John Swinney. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to speak in this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. As people have said, it may be perhaps a rather dry topic, but a hugely important one. The amendments to the fiscal framework adopted this August and agreed by Seán Robison are an adjustment from the original agreement signed by John Swinney in 2016. The updated arrangement will see the index per capita mechanism for calculating the ROC grant adopted permanently, which protects the Scottish budget from the risk of slower population growth. The main impact, according to the independent report, is on the block grant adjustment for tax, which could be worth around £200 million a year after 5 years and circa £400 million after 10 years. A key element to Scotland's finances is the Parliament's ability to scrutinise public spending. Yep. Alongside the devolution of further powers to the Scottish Parliament, the Smith Commission recommended that the Scottish Parliament should expand and strengthen independent financial scrutiny of Scotland's public finances. Now, this is set against the worrying situation that was highlighted by my colleague Liz Smith around the increasing lack of transparency and scrutiny of the fiscal framework, as can be seen by the issues the Finance Committee come up against when they sought to scrutinise said framework. This became so bad as to necessitate a letter from the convener to the committee to the Deputy First Minister intimating that the level of scrutiny requested and agreed on by the Scottish Government was not delivered. And given that the committees of this Parliament are charged with scrutinising Scottish Government policy, this is a worrying trend mirrored with the ongoing issues Audit Scotland are having with financial transparency from the SNP Government. More especially because financial scrutiny of the fiscal framework impacts every aspect of public spend, and it's crucial to the future of Scotland's economy. This cannot be allowed to continue. I will give way.
John Mason.
We actually accept that this is also a problem at Westminster, because neither did their Parliament were they able to scrutinise the agreement.
Brian Whittle.
Yep, I wouldn't disagree with that. I think it's important for governments to be transparent, and I'm not going to argue with that one at all. Government is about choice, and how those choices are being made. Increasingly, a veil of secrecy is descending on the SNP as the outcomes of their financial decisions are coming to the fore. Fiscal framework is about the devolution settlement, which in turn, as I said, funds our public services. It's about both governments working together for the benefit of Scotland and the UK, which is exactly what the public want to see. The trouble is, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that the SNP government, for the SNP Green government to succeed on their ultimate objective, devolution has to fail. And let's face it, the Scottish Government funding and handling of our public services is hardly delivering the outcomes we all want and the public need. We have a health service in crisis with record waiting times. Can I just finish this point, please? Record waiting times and a consistent poor health outcomes, despite the Scottish Government consistently claiming that they have record investment. We have a housing emergency, and probably the most worrying of all, with the recent PISA results just published, we see the consequence of SNP mismanagement of the education system and letting down of our teachers and pupils, despite claims by the Scottish Government of increased numbers of teachers. And I'll give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
So, thanks for giving way. Mentioned the issue of investment in public services. Does Brian Whittle believe that the autumn statement, which gave £10.8 million to the health service from consequentials. Does he think that helps investment in the health service, or does he think it hinders investment in the health service when every commentating body has said the autumn statement is at the expense of investment in public services?
Prime Minister.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her intervention, because it allows me just to highlight exactly how the SNP government approach these questions. What they want to do here, they'll say on the one hand they say we have record investment, and on the other hand they say we don't have enough. And Deputy Presiding Officer, it's outcomes that ultimately matter, and we have an increase in the waiting times in our health service, and we have increasingly poor health outcomes from our health service. How you spend the money matters. The fiscal framework is only one side of the coin. How the Scottish Government manages the budget is the other. Handily, of course, as we have just heard there, they have a built-in excuse that everything bad is due to a lack of funding through the Barnett consequentials. It does seem strange to me, Deputy Presiding Officer, we have a First Minister who, at every First Minister's questions, laments a lack of money through the Barnett formula, yet his and his party's solution is to be independent with the £10 billion black hole in finances that would ensue.
Yep.
It's a question that has dogged the SNP for years, and one that they have consistently refused to or been unable to answer. And it matters, Deputy Presiding Officer. Now, I watched the Smith Commission all those years ago, and I remember all the party's protagonists being interviewed about the process and the outcomes. And I remember John Swinney being very pragmatic, saying that he didn't get all that he wanted, but got more than the other side had wanted to give. And that was the nature of negotiation. And I thought to myself, what a very good way of summing up that process. However, the very next day, the very same Deputy First Minister and all of his parties, every day since, I was declaring to anyone who was holding a microphone that Scotland had been shortchanged. And I thought, if it was that bad, why did you sign the declaration, Deputy Presiding Officer, to an outsider? Something as technical and complicated as the fiscal framework is pretty dry material for a speech. In fact, even to an insider, it's pretty dry material. But in closing, I would like to quote from a speech by Charlie Munger, Vice Chairman of Warren Buffett's Berkshire Hathaway, who died just a few days ago. In a speech to graduates at the University of South Carolina Law School, he said this: "The last idea that I want to give you as you go out into a profession that frequently puts a lot of procedure and a lot of precaution and a lot of mumbo-jumbo into what it does, this is not the highest form of civilization that you can reach. The highest form that civilization can reach is a seamless web of deserved trust. Not much procedure, just totally reliable people correctly trusting one another." As I come to the end of the speech in Scotland's fiscal framework review, I'm bound to ask if, more than anything, Scotland wouldn't benefit from a little more time spent by its government and politicians building trust and a little less procedural mumbo-jumbo. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. I call John Swinney to be followed by Alec Riley. Mr. Swinney.
Presiding Officer, having negotiated the inaugural fiscal framework in 2016, I know and appreciate how difficult a challenge it is for the Scottish Government to secure a broadly acceptable set of financial arrangements with the United Kingdom Treasury. I therefore warmly commend the Deputy First Minister for being able to secure the agreement that was announced some weeks ago and which is the subject of debate today. The agreement essentially represents a building upon the agreement that was put in place in 2016. Crucially, the agreement embeds on a permanent basis the use of the index per capita mechanism for calculating block grant adjustments. This was the key issue of negotiation in 2016. And I can say to Brian Whittle, there would be no fiscal framework agreement, and there would have been no fiscal framework agreement in 2016 if that provision had not been in place. And I made that expressly clear to committees of this Parliament on constant occasions. Indeed, I'm reminded that in 2016, I'm very sorry that Willie Rennie isn't here for my speech today because I'm going to mention him, that Willie Rennie said to the First Minister of the time in 2016 that the Scottish Government had made a fundamental error in accepting this model because we would never be able to protect it at the point of review. Well, the Deputy First Minister has just not only protected this model at review, she has embedded it permanently, which we were unable to secure in 2016, which is a formidable achievement. So the model that underpins the fiscal framework is essential to protect the public finances of Scotland, because we already carry population risk in the Barnett formula, and the index per capita mechanism was necessary to provide the long-term stability. Now, of course.
Liz Smith.
I'm very glad to hear Mr Swinney making these comments, because to give him credit, in 2016, that was a difficult job. He did that job. The Deputy First Minister has done the job in 2023. So can I ask him if he disagrees with Ash Regan when she says that this particular fiscal framework is worse than the previous one?
John Swinney?
Yes, I do disagree with that point of view, and I'll come on to explain why I think that's the case. Mr Mara has made a curious contribution to... I can't decide whether it was curious or churlish, because if Mr Mara speculated that he wanted more time to decide if the index per capita mechanism was preferable to the comparable method. Well, the comparable method is the proposition of the Conservative Treasury. Mr Rowley, over there on the Labour benches, had the good... I'll give way to Mr Mara in a second. The good grace to recognise in 2016 the achievement the government had made by seeing off the comparable method. And here Mr Mara is inviting the Conservative Treasury to inflict it upon us. I've never heard such folly in my life.
Michael Mara.
I can assure the member that he didn't hear such folly here either. That's not what I said. What I said was it would be good if actually the Parliament was able to scrutinise all of these options and talk about them, have them explained by the Deputy First Minister, the ups and downs, so that we can all get behind that the conclusion that you come to, if it indeed is the right one.
If indeed it is the right one. So there I rest my case that Mr Mara's speculation on what is the right outcome. If he'd gone back and looked at what Alec Rowley, Jackie Bailey and crucially, Malcolm Chisholm said in 2006, Malcolm Chisholm was my strongest ally in negotiating the outcome I negotiated in 2016, because he could see the dangers of a rampant UK Treasury on us with the comparable method that Mr Mara is now embracing. If Mr Mara is to be at the helm of negotiations in the future, heaven help Scotland, is all I can say. Now, one of the reasons why the Scottish Government was able to negotiate, in my view, and this is where I disagree with Ash Regan earlier on, a broadly acceptable fiscal framework in 2016, and to protect that at the point of review, was down to one word, and that word was agree. The Smith Commission concluded that the Scottish Government and the UK Government must agree a fiscal framework. Not that the UK Government should consult with the Scottish Government, the usual weasel words, not that there should be a discussion, but that the UK Government and the Scottish Government must agree a fiscal framework. I kept the Smith Commission meeting late into the night to make sure that single word got into the agreement in the final wording, because my experience told me that if we did not have the ability to be treated as an equal in that conversation, we would be steamrolled by the UK Treasury. So we now know that agreement mattered, because the independent report published around this agreement made clear that the fiscal framework arrangements and securing the index per capita mechanism, which I consider to have been a mighty achievement and essential for Scotland, have prevented the loss of approximately £500 million per annum from the public finances of Scotland. So for me, presiding officer, there is a deep lesson for Scotland in this respect. Unless we are treated as equals, we are likely to lose out. Look at what's happened in other areas of intergovernmental relations. The passage of the Internal Market Act, without our consent, has undermined devolution. The passage of the Subsidy Control Act, without our consent, has undermined devolutions. Where we are not equals, we will lose out. And that's been demonstrated in the autumn statement. We are losing out badly because we are at the mercy of decisions taken to suit the political agenda of the United Kingdom Treasury, where they can use their power to overwhelm the interests of Scotland, and where we are not treated as equals. So, presiding officer, in drawing my remarks to a conclusion, I draw the simple lesson that Scotland will only prosper where we are treated as an equal, and I want us to be treated equally as an independent country.
Thank you, Mr Swinney. And I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by John Mason. Mr Rowley.
Presiding officer, this debate is being held today with a background of financial instability, a sluggish performance, Scottish and UK economy, and many of our public services buckling under immense financial pressure. So the fact that the Scottish and UK governments have reached agreement on a fiscal framework providing greater funding clarity for Scotland is welcome, as is the news that some more flexibility on how the Scottish Government manages the public finances has been agreed. I have found that when asking people what is the fiscal framework, the most common answers is it is very technical or it's very difficult to understand. Although complex, the fiscal framework sets out the rules for how devolution of tax and social security powers following the Scotland Act 2016 is supposed to work in terms of finances. It sets out the mechanisms by which the Scottish Block Grant is adjusted to reflect the fact that large amounts of tax and social security powers are now the responsibility of the Scottish Parliament. I note that the Scottish Government say the agreement protects the Scottish budget from the risk of Scotland's population growing at a slower rate than the rest of the UK. This risk is a reality and is one of the many areas where the Government must use the powers it has to address Scotland's population concerns by putting in place a coherent strategy to encourage people to come to Scotland, work in Scotland and make Scotland their home. I'm sure the Government will say we need more powers over areas such as immigration, but that cannot be used as an excuse to do nothing to address the chronic lack of housing, poor skills and training opportunities, poor access to public services such as health, and no industrial strategy for Scotland's future. Although welcome, the review has also come in for criticism in the way it has been dealt with and the lack of wider inclusion in the discussions. Professor David Bell of Stirling University raised the issue by stating, "This review is of substantial importance for the Scottish budget and therefore for the services it delivers to the public during the cost of living crisis." He goes on to say, "Why then has the review attracted so little interest from the public and the media other than the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament, especially when our report, produced alongside colleagues from the Institute of Fiscal Studies and the University of Strathclyde, show that different approaches to the fiscal framework could cause Scotland's budget to vary by hundreds of millions of pounds in the medium to long term. So I think it's fair to ask the Scottish Government, is this a short-term fix for a short-term budget pressures?" Jim Cuthbert, writing in Commonweal, argues that the review leaves Scotland exposed to the likelihood of being forced into a cycle of relative economic decline in comparison to the rest of the UK. He argues that because the review was conducted in secrecy, we do not know how these damaging outcomes came about. Yeah.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think to answer the two fundamental points Alec Rowley is making, well firstly, we were absolutely keen to have transparency and openness, but the Chief Secretary of the Treasury wanted it to be conducted in a confidential space. Given it had to be an agreement, I don't think we would have made progress had that not been the case. And in terms of the wider point of the narrowness of the review, we would have wanted it to be more expansive. But again, if it's a negotiation, you can only land on where there's negotiating space. Well, Alec Rowley recognised that of the constraint that we were operating under.
Alec Rowley.
Well, I think a number of committees in this Parliament should have been engaged at an earlier stage and been involved in this. The last Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, in June 22, wrote to the Finance Social Justice Committee informing them about the review and how it was planned. And at that point, she was definitely saying that there would be engagement and consultation with a number of parliamentary committees as the review progressed. So I think, you know, the government should have been pushing and should have been engaging with those committees. We've seen the experts that in academia that are criticising the lack of that review. So I would say we need to stand up and be much firmer to defend the democratic rights of the committees of this Parliament and the wider consultation that should have taken place. But I suppose, so the fair question for me is, what changed? The Cabinet Secretary has just said the UK Government changed their view. I don't think we just have to cave in every time the UK Government say that's how they want to deal with these issues. Uh, But I note the Deputy First Minister welcomed the agreement, also says that, that we have a challenging situation going forward. And I would say that I would like to hear more from the government about what they're going to do in terms of addressing our poorly performing economy here in Scotland. How will we use the budget? How are we going to actually address that? What is the plan? Does this agreement with the UK government support or hinder economic growth and investment in public services? Likewise, there is no doubt we're facing that challenging situation. There's no doubt that we're facing that challenging situation where many core services, as I have said, are buckling, and central government and local government. In such circumstances, in conclusion, I believe the question must be asked by the government, and that is, are we spending the money we have in the most effective and efficient way? We know it's going to be tough, but we must ensure that every penny, the taxpayers' money in Scotland, is being spent in the most effective and efficient way, and I look forward to the budget.
Thank you. I now call John Mason to be followed by Ivan McKee. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much. I do consider that the fiscal framework is an extremely important topic, although I do accept that, say, for some people it is a bit dry and technical, and they would prefer it to leave it to the Finance Committee and a few other anoraks to sort it out. We had expected that the initial report by David Bell, David Isser and David Phillips would be first published and then discussed, to be followed by a wider ranging review with at least some public input and debate around the options before the two governments negotiated and reached an agreement. As had happened in 2016, the Finance Committee was probably willing to accept that at least some of the negotiations would be carried out in private between the two administrations. However, what we did not expect was the sudden announcement in August that the report was being published, the review had been greatly narrowed in scope, and agreement had been reached all in one go. This has meant that the opportunity for input and scrutiny by either Parliament or their committees was very limited indeed. Now, Shona Robinson has told us that the Westminster government made it clear that a wider review was not on the table. So that is the first problem. Even without Scotland being independent, if we had a federal system, as I think Gordon Brown suggested we might be close to, there would be a written constitution with certain checks and balances. But the severe downside of devolution is that ultimately Westminster is judge, jury and executioner. And they say, what they say goes, and if Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland do not like it, well, tough luck. If Westminster says a wider review is not on the table, then a wider review is not on the table. So we are left in the position that there are some improvements over what was in place during the first 5 years. In particular, some of the restrictions around borrowing are being eased. But even on borrowing, it would have been good to see the introduction of a prudential framework. That is the system which local government has. That is, they can borrow what they can afford to service, rather than being limited by a fixed ceiling. That system has generally worked for local government, and I see no good reason why the Scottish Government could not have had that system as well. In fact, the Smith Commission itself said that a prudential borrowing regime should be considered by both governments. And of course, capital borrowing cannot just be spent on day-to-day expenditure. It is for the likes of building houses and electrifying the railways, which benefit Scotland's people and Scotland's economy in the longer term. However, perhaps the more serious implications of this second agreement is that we seem to be locked into a system which is weighted against Scotland. As economist Jim Cuthbert and Colman Wheel point out, as others have referred to, the block grant system, even under the index per capita method, means that Scotland is engaged in a fiscal race with the rest of the UK. Generally speaking, we do match or outperform regions of England, Wales and Northern Ireland, for example, on inward investment. But the problem is London and the south-east of England, as Ash Reagan pointed out. No other region of Europe has been able to match that region, so it should be little surprise that Scotland toils to do so as well. Briefly, yes.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for John Mason for giving way. If London and the south-east is such a huge cash cow for Scotland, why on earth do you want to sever ties with it?
John Mason.
Well, I'm just going to quote somebody just in a two paragraphs, so if you just wait, I shall get to that quote, which he may remember. For example, if you look at output per hour or output per job under London and the South East, only London and the South East are above the UK average. Scotland comes third, but is still below the UK average. while being ahead of every other part. And I'm reminded of the words of Vince Cable 10 years ago in December 2013, when he said, "One of the big problems that we have at the moment is that London is becoming a kind of giant suction machine, draining the life out of the rest of the country." And he said, "More balance in that respect would be helpful." Well, I agree with him. And although we have the per capita method, a lack of immigration to Scotland holds back our economy, and I would certainly argue that the fact we do not get our fair share of immigration is outwith the Scottish Government's control. One reason, for example, would be that people already have family connections in London or the English Midlands, so they want to stay there. Now, the independent report noted that the Smith Commission did not say the Scottish budget should bear the risk of all divergence in tax revenue growth, but only the divergence that is the result of policy decisions. However, because it is so difficult or even impossible to identify the causes of divergent revenue growth, we end up taking all of the risks, even those out with our control. It is worth noting the Barnett formula too at this point. The other week I asked about the convergence in spending which the Barnett formula was intended to have. The answer from David Phillips of IFS was that this convergence had not really happened before 2020, but is happening now. In 2019, spend per capita in Scotland for devolved services was about 129% of the average for England. It is now about 125%. He expects that by the close of this decade, it will be about 122% and will fall below 120% by the mid-2030s. In the longer term, given current population projections, he expects that to converge to around 115%. So all in all, we were promised a union dividend if we stayed in the UK, and some people probably voted no in the 2014 referendum, believing that we'd be better off financially if London paid the bills. But now we see that any union dividend is being increasingly eroded, any advantages of being in the UK are being lost year by year, day by day. And while we're at it, there does seem to be an increasingly arrogant and disparaging attitude from Westminster towards this Parliament. In the past, Treasury ministers appeared before the Finance Committee, as Kenny Gibson said, a number of times, but they adamantly refused to do so now, saying they are only answerable to MPs, and even ministers who agree to come keep postponing the date. So as the motion says, we recognise the limited improvements, but there is something fundamentally flawed in the relationship between Scotland and Westminster. One of these days, it will have to be sorted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Ivan McKee to be followed by Richard Leonard. Up to 6 minutes, Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm delighted to speak in this debate today. And one thing I will agree with Michael Marr, probably the only thing I'll agree with him in my speech today, is it would be good to have more economy and finance debates in this chamber. I recognise the progress in securing the deal on the fiscal framework, and thanks to all those involved in those negotiations, particularly, of course, the much-mentioned securing of index per capita methodology versus the comparable method for the long term. Of course, that is all based on Scotland's population growth or lack of it, something I'm going to return to later in my remarks. Of course, we've secured a welcome increase in borrowing limits, not enough, of course, and the use of reserves is welcome, as is inflation proofing. As I say, this is not enough because, given the scale of the fiscal shocks that have occurred and will occur potentially going forward, be it Brexit, COVID, austerity, and whatever else is round the corner, as Mr Swinney has referenced, it's hugely important that we have the ability to have as much flexibility around about those fiscal measures as possible. But of course, the key point, as the DFM has highlighted, is that we're still very much at the mercy of UK policy decisions taken at Westminster, very often not with Scotland's interests at heart. And the DFM has outlined the impact of Tory austerity on public service funding going forward with the recent autumn statement. And of course, signals from Labour are not encouraging. We've now got Keir Starmer praising Margaret Thatcher, which is not boding well for any potential future UK Labour government with regards to their approach to these policies. It's important, of course, though, to remember what levers are not devolved. We talk about income tax, but, of course, much of income tax, round about dividends and savings, is, of course, not devolved, and that, of course, limits the possibility and the options for Scottish policy to be able to mitigate against behavioural impact, something that impacts significantly on the tax measures that we have taken in this regard recently. And of course, the full range of business taxation, corporation tax, investment breaks, and so on and so forth are not devolved, which limits the ability of the Scottish Government to direct support and taxation measure that will help stimulate and support economic growth within our economy, tailored to the sectors and the opportunities that we have within the Scottish economy. It was interesting, Liz Smith, straight out of the blocks, was quite clear about where it is we're trying to get to, our ultimate goal, to have no need for the fiscal framework when Scotland has full control over economic policy, something certainly on these benches we're working very hard to secure as soon as possible. So I think it's helpful to see the fiscal framework as a stepping stone to those full powers of economic independence. And the complexities that have been referenced in that, frankly, are something that we'll be glad to see the back of when we move beyond the need to have to negotiate this complex situation with the UK, the UK government, once we have those full powers. Of course, Scotland with full powers over borrowing, it will be interesting to see when we're independent, so it will be interesting to see in the meantime how the issuing of Scottish bonds, or kilts, as I think we can call them, will be taken forward over the next period. And I look forward to seeing how that develops with interest. The Scottish Government needs to continue, of course, to negotiate with Westminster to get the best deal while we are under devolution, but also at the same time with a focus on the preparations we need to do to deal with and use to best effect the full powers of independence when they come to this Parliament, hopefully in the not too distant future. On immigration powers, and again returning to the comments on population and the impact that has had on potential funding solutions going forward. With full immigration powers, we can of course focus on growing Scotland's population in the way it needs to. A very different approach, of course, from the UK government's obsession with reducing immigration that we saw again this week, and again Labour mirroring those policies and that approach, again with their clarity from them on their support for the misguided policy of Brexit. But of course, in the meantime, it's very important that we use the powers that we do have, and people tend to forget, and I'll make the point again because it's very well worth making, more people move from the rest of the UK working age population to Scotland and move in the opposite direction, something we need to encourage more of within the current context to maximise Scotland's population. And frankly, with pulling all the right levers, I believe that we can actually secure a Scottish population growth, even under the current settlement that matches that of the rest of the UK. With regards to economic powers, we can, of course, focus those on growing Scotland's economy. I would take some issue, if I've understood them correctly, and apologies if I haven't, with Jim Cuthbert's very helpful paper, which seemed to assume that tax cuts were the only way to grow an economy. I would argue that that is absolutely not the only way to grow the economy. An intelligent focus on business growth and stimulating businesses through that regard and supporting the sectors that are the future of the world economy, and indeed Scotland has great potential, is the way to do that. We should be doing, of course, as much of that as we can under the current settlement, but continuing to focus and argue for more powers. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I take issue with the comments that Brian Whittle made. Well, I think if I heard him right, he said that it's in our interest for devolution not to work. Quite the contrary. At the end of the day, the people of Scotland will support independence. It will become the settled will of the people of the Scotland when they see excellent delivery from this government with the powers that we have. We need to continue to move forward and deliver on that, while at the same time arguing for more and more powers to come to this Parliament in the meantime. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Up to 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, if devolution is a process, not an event, the long-awaited outcome of this fiscal framework review is less like an advance and more like a stoppage. The government motion before us this afternoon speaks of, and I quote, limited improvements and of limited progress. It's a quite deliberate, calculated selection of vocabulary intended to con us into talking of the limits of devolution, why devolution does not work, why devolution cannot work, why devolution should be scrapped. Because if we are honest, that is the government's policy, that's what's in today's government motion. But the real limits, which the outcome of the fiscal framework actually lays bare, is the limited ambition and limited horizons of this government on fiscal reform. It lays bare once again the limited acquaintance of this government with transparency and openness, with engagement, with scrutiny, with meaningful consultation. And I'm bound to say that it lays bare the limited negotiating skills of the Deputy First Minister and the unlimited mediocrity and complacency of the Cabinet which surrounds her. Our starting point is that the fiscal framework, which the Cabinet Secretary's predecessor signed up to in 2016, was both a rushed deal and a bad deal. Of course it's good that Scotland benefits in full from tax revenues which are raised as a result of Scottish Parliament fiscal policy decisions. But what is not so good is that if the Scottish economy performs poorly compared to the rest of the UK, including London and the South East, if we have no economic plan, no industrial strategy, no jobs first, just transition plan, but we leave it to market forces, if we experience a downturn in a sector like oil and gas, then the block grant is cut. What is also defective, what is also bad about this deal, is that if more people are in receipt of social security payments in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK, then there is another cut in the block grant. We are told that this is applying, I quote, the economic responsibility principle. But I have to say that it is a so-called principle which is morally irresponsible, socially counterintuitive, and economically counterproductive. Block grant adjustments on social security should not be downwards, they should be upwards, on the principle of to each according to their need, from each according to their means. Let's be clear that what we have before us are what the Institute for Fiscal Studies describes as these modest changes to borrowing and revenue power. We've got to be more radical, bolder. We've got to be better than that. It's my view, and it may not be Labour Party policy anymore, but it remains my view, that the Scottish Government should be able to borrow and issue bonds prudentially for both revenue and capital spending without restriction. Why shouldn't this Parliament at least have parity with our local councils? It also remains my view that the Treasury's cap on the amount of reserves which can be held by the Scottish Government should be completely removed, that those decisions should be entirely devolved. In its medium-term financial strategy, which it launched back in May, the government set out its negotiation aims for the fiscal framework review. And let me quote them. The planned review of the fiscal framework is an important opportunity to address the limitations of borrowing and reserve powers. But those limitations have not been addressed at all. There's been limited engagement because this nationalist government does not want it to be reformed, does not want it to be successful. The Deputy First Minister would rather appear on national television and announce public service job cuts, that the public sector workforce will have to shrink, than come to this Parliament and hold a proper debate and find solutions. These matters are not complicated. They are simple. They are not technical. They are political. This is no time for tinkering around the edges. The government has negotiated a bad deal. The Deputy First Minister's depiction of the changes as balanced and pragmatic, that is what she told me when she wrote to me on the 2nd of August, is selling the people a long way short. In the end, it is a review with an agreement between two governments which we, as a Parliament, are being asked to assent to. We should not, in all conscience, agree to these terms, to this limited vision, or to this abject abandonment of any fighting spirit. We need a new deal a new fiscal framework, a fresh start, and this is not it.
Thank you, Mr. Laird. I now call Stuart McMillan, who is the final speaker in the open debate, up to 6 minutes. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, Presiding Officer, I think just a wee comment regarding Richard Leonard. Mr. Leonard, devolution limits ambition, not independence. And a comment to get to Mr. Mara. Mr. Mara spoke in his earlier comments regarding the fiscal framework, and if Labour were to win the next UK election, there should be further discussions. But what Mr. Mara didn't say was that more money would actually come to Scotland with those future discussions. Now, Mr. Singh, also, we have heard a lot today across the chamber, and it will come as no surprise that I certainly will not be supporting some of the amendments, but actually all the amendments that we've got in front of us. I note that the Lib Dem amendment speaks positively about the Smith Commission report of 2014. This will be the same Smith Commission that in section 18 it does not prevent, and I quote, Scotland becoming an independent country in the future should the people of Scotland so choose. It's a pity that the Lib Dems are on the same page as other pro-union parties wanting to prevent people in Scotland from actually having their say. Now, first of all, I do welcome the modest or limited improvements in the fiscal framework, such as the indexed per capita mechanism for calculating block grant adjustments to be adopted on a permanent basis, the amount the Scottish Government can borrow to mitigate against the errors in forecasting to increase from £300 million to £600 million, with no limits to the amount that can be drawn from the Scotland Reserve, and also the borrowing and reserve limits to grow in line with inflation. However, the sad reality of the situation is that these changes will not be able to protect Scotland and our economy or social fabric in the years ahead. Only independence and access to the full range of powers will be able to do that. Now, since the fiscal framework was agreed in early 2016, it has been thoroughly stress-tested. Okay.
Michael Mara.
Does Stuart McMillan not recognise, as along with any objective academic looking at this, there would be significant fiscal, immediate fiscal costs to independence? We're having a fiscal debate here, a little bit of honesty, between £10 and £14 billion immediately in terms of the amount of money available to Scotland.
Stuart McMillan.
I look at the situation that we have actually had. Certainly going back to the 1970s, the amount of money that Scotland, additional money Scotland's put into the Treasury in comparison to what we've actually received back. So I know that independence is the only way forward for Scotland. The only way for Scotland to actually deal with many of the issues that we face as a society. It's not with the limited powers of devolution, and it's certainly not the situation we had pre-devolution when all the powers were reserved to Westminster. I mean, I generally do believe that it was right that the arrangements actually were reviewed. And they're taken together and within the context of the narrowly scoped review that was on offer, these are meaningful but limited improvements to the framework and the financial management tools that are available to the Scottish Government. We shouldn't lose sight of the scale of the fiscal challenge in the aftermath of the COVID pandemic, the ongoing costs of living crisis and the urgent need to tackle the climate change, in addition to also the fact we've had such an economic shock because of Brexit brought on by the Tories. And all the changes to the framework are welcome, they are not the size needed to offset the broader fiscal challenge that we actually face. This requires action by the UK Government. Now, the Scottish Government will still need to make tough choices in the context of a poorly performing UK economy and the constraints of devolution to ensure that finances remain sustainable. But sadly, Scotland is once again at the mercy of poor UK government decisions that compound the pressures on our public finances and increase the misery that struggling households face. Now, neither Rishi Sunak nor Keir Starmer will change course from the damaging Westminster policies that got the UK into this mess in the first place. And as a result of the UK government's disastrous handling of the economy, projected growth is just 0.7% next year. And inflation is still running at more than twice the UK government's target. Now, living standards are forecast to be 3.5% lower in 2024-25 than pre-pandemic. And this would be the largest reduction in real living standards since records began in the 1950s. Now, ultimately, Presiding Officer, Westminster is holding Scotland back. The Brexit is making us poorer, and continued Westminster control is making the situation worse. Now, this week alone, we heard from Labour's Sir Keir Starmer, the newest member of the Margaret Thatcher fan club, and he said, and I quote, "Anyone who expects an incoming Labour government to quickly turn on the spending taps is going to be disappointed." He also said, "This Parliament, that's the UK Parliament, is on track to be the first in modern history where living standards in this country, i.e. the UK, have actually contracted. Household income growth is down by 3.1% and Britain is worse off. And I'm sure, I genuinely am sure that I will encourage many people in Scotland to pay attention to this particular point. And I know this will actually change the minds of many people in Scotland when it comes to the issue of independence. Keir Starmer also said, "This is Britain going backwards. This is worse than the 1970s, worse than the recessions of the 1980s and 90s, and worse even than the Great Crash of 2008. Presenting also with an economic record like this, going back to the 1970s according to Labour, but to the 1950s according to the official records, why on earth would Scots want to continue living in a political environment where the only thing that's going to be guaranteed is for more poverty, desperation and misery that is so prevalent within this so-called union? Britain is bankrupt and it's also broken. It's also morally bankrupt. We consider a lot of the policies that the Tories have actually brought on and wrought on many of our people in our country. One example in particular is the WASPI women. They've been robbed of their pensions, and that's absolutely shocking. Presiding officer, I certainly mean I could go on, but I know I do not have the time. So this fiscal framework, it may help a little, but it still falls far short of what is needed, and that is independence. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. We now move to the wind-up speeches, and I call first Ash Regan, up to 6 minutes. Ms Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In my opening remarks, I set out my conceptualisation of responsibility without power being a very dismal situation to find yourself in. And my motion, I know, speaks about VAT, so I want to just take a little bit of time just to talk that over, because I think it also goes some way to reinforcing that conceptualisation. So the Scotland Act of 2016 states that receipts from the first 10 pence of standard rate of VAT and the first 2.5 pence of reduced rate of VAT in Scotland would be assigned to the Scottish Government's budget. So VAT would be the second largest source of tax revenue for the Scottish Government after income tax. But despite this, the new framework has not managed to navigate a path in order to deliver it. And of course, the presiding officer, the key word above there is assigned. I'll give way.
Liz Smith.
I'm very grateful to Ash Regan giving way. Is she aware of the fact that when the current Finance Committee took evidence about this VAT assignment, and also when our predecessor committee, the Finance and Constitution Committee, took evidence, I'm afraid there was unanimity that it was far too difficult and complex to actually make that assignment?
Ash Regan.
I do understand that, but I think that there's a metaphor there, really, isn't there, for the fiscal framework as a whole. That it's complicated, it's difficult to get this to work in Scotland's favour, and I think we've heard that across the chamber today. So VAT being assigned rather than devolved means that even if the promises of the Smith Commission were delivered, the Scottish Government would not have any direct policy control over VAT. And if the framework did allow for VAT to come to the Scottish budget as it's supposed to do, that VAT will continue to be collected by HMRC at the UK level, and the amount of tax assigned to Scotland would require to be estimated using a model developed by HMRC, the Treasury and the Scottish Government, which makes the point that the member has just raised about the complexity of it. But the VAT assignment, a further 15% of Scottish budget, would be based on VAT revenues raised in Scotland. But I think we need to think about this. That would be 15% of the entire Scottish budget, but no control. That's the key point here. No control for the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government, as to what VAT should be set at. So I do think this goes some way to illustrating the difficulty for Scotland in this framework, whether it's the previous framework or the revised one. So I remember, it's some time ago now, when I was on the Finance and Constitution Committee, as it used to be called, back in 2016, and I listened to presentations where they were setting out, from experts, setting out the previous fiscal framework at that time. And I understood that the way it was constructed made it extremely, extremely difficult, if not even impossible, for Scotland to succeed under that framework. And I'm afraid that nothing I have heard since then and nothing that I have heard today has convinced me otherwise on that point. But I just want to take a little bit of time now to talk about the debates that we've taken part in this afternoon. So Michael Mara
generally, I think, a fairly dispiriting speech. However, he did make some interesting and, I think, important remarks around the issues of timing, around secrecy and scrutiny on the review process itself. And I think that considering how important, I know we've said this afternoon this is probably quite a dry subject, but it's very, very important to Scotland. I think there should be potentially more involvement for the public, more involvement for parliamentary committees and experts. And that was picked up as well by Kenny Gibson. He spoke particularly about more involvement for the Scottish Parliament and I'm sure for the committee that he is involved in. Michelle Thompson echoed my own comments, I think, when she spoke about PPP and the very, very poor value that it represents to the public purse and how whilst the UK has now been able to, it's in this privileged position where it can now move away from this model of funding public infrastructure, whilst Scotland is not in such a privileged position and the fiscal framework is locking Scotland into its use. And I think that should be of interest to everybody in this chamber. Ivan McKee spoke about Jim Cuthbert and he used the quote that tax cuts are the only way to grow the economy. And he admitted he wasn't sure if that was the point that Mr. Cuthbert was going for. I don't believe that is what he was saying. I think what Mr. Cuthbert is reflecting there is in that comment was in fact the Treasury view. The Treasury view, of course, being that the only way that Scotland could minimise economic harm to itself via the fiscal framework is to accept that economic straitjacket that the Conservatives would propose to Scotland. Now, Presiding Officer, in my earlier remarks, I focused on what my view is that in comparison to the full flexibility that we might have, the full fiscal autonomy we would give to Scotland, that this new fiscal framework, this review, is in fact a bad deal for Scotland. And no amount of tinkering around the edges will suffice to change my view on that. And I'm sure the Scottish Government benches will agree with me that only with the powers of independence can Scotland truly flourish and grow. And only with economic separation from Westminster can we ensure that our policy priorities, those of the Scottish people, are matched by the fiscal levers of the Scottish Government. But we can, of course, only have those levers, and Scotland can only have that power by becoming an independent country.
Thank you, Ms. Regan. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton up to 6 minutes. Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have welcomed this afternoon's robust debate. And broadly, I welcome the steps the Government has taken to get the framework to where it is, particularly around embedding the per capita nature of it. I think the Deputy First Minister and I will agree on several aspects of the conduct of the UK Government and the decisions in particular taken by HM Treasury, which have held our economy back and cost our constituents dearly. The disastrous incompetence of the Truss Quarteng plan will have ramifications for household budgets for years, particularly mortgages and the price people pay in the shops. But they are not alone in being held to blame. Much of this also lies at the door of St Andrew's House as well. In terms of a stagnant growth outlook for our economy, the Scottish Government is principally to blame for that. The Deputy First Minister asks for the devolution in her motion of all fiscal levers to the Scottish Government, but does not inspire confidence that they would know what to do with them if they were so offered. A decade and more to establish a welfare system that they said would only take 18 months. Liz Smith was quite right, I think, to say that this debate really matters, this framework really matters, not just the mechanics of financial interplay, but also in the cooperation that should always exist between our two governments. We need grown-ups at the helm, and we need those grown-ups in a room talking about the interests of the people we are all sent here to represent. It is the duty of Scottish ministers to therefore use that framework to get the best deal through the framework for all of our constituents. This fiscal framework is about respect. It's about respect across levels of government. And here there is an irony that you could find it hard to escape. And I come back to the Verity House Agreement. Now, that isn't a fiscal framework, but that did point to a fiscal framework that it is hoped will be established between central and local government in the coming months. It talked about a presumption against ring fencing, about allowing authorities to take greater control over the levers, financial levers, that can make decisions robust decisions for the interests of their communities. And it, as I say, it called for an establishment of its own localised fiscal framework. But that respect and that trust were shattered by this government at the SNP conference with the announcement about council tax. And laying aside the merits or otherwise of that policy, it does show a level of contempt that this government has shown for local authorities, not just in the policies that it enacts, but also in the way it has asset stripped them over the years in the budget block grant. Michael Mara, I think in an excellent speech, brought us back to the topic of growth, or the lack thereof, because much of that failure is entirely homegrown. And the environment for business investment is hardly inviting at the moment. Indeed, Green ministers, who are manifestly disinterested in national growth, are presiding over things like a deposit return scheme that, had it not been abandoned, would have seen Scottish products removed from Scottish shelves. I don't have time to go through every other speech, but I did want to thank Richard Leonard for injecting a little bit of life into an otherwise quite stuffy debate. Can I also just speak to, before I move on to the substance of my remarks, can I speak to Ash Reagan's remarks? And can I welcome her to her place as the leader of the ALBA party? I am interested in aspects of her motion. We won't be supporting it today, but I would be interested to hear more from the minister about the discussions that were had between the two governments on VAT. I have to say, our approach is that we shouldn't devolve just for show, and changes to how we are governed... But changes to how we are governed should be underpinned by a clear framework and understanding of how it will make people better off, how it will grow our economy, and how it will make a difference. I'm not clear that the aspects of around VAT in Ash Regan's motion adequately explain that. Presiding officer, to create opportunity and to... I will absolutely...
John Swinney. Can we have Mr. Swinney's microphone? Mr. Swinney's microphone, please.
I'm grateful, President Officer. If I can help Mr. Cole-Hamilton on this particular point about VAT assignment, the drift of the conversation in the Smith Commission was entirely about assigning VAT for the purposes of show, so that the proportion of revenues that were supposedly under the control of the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament, could be demonstrated to be over 50%. It was a fig leaf.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Well, that was certainly worth the wait. Well, I'm grateful to the former Deputy First Minister for his intervention, and I bow to his superior knowledge, having sat on that commission. And I think he underscores my point that, that there's no point devolving powers if it doesn't mean anything. To create opportunity to grow the tax base, we need to end the era of this meagre growth that we've been living in. Scotland has all the ingredients needed to be at the forefront of industries, including things like life sciences, green energy, fintech. But in the SNP, we have a chef that just can't be trusted to bring those ingredients together. We need to start by investing in our people, and nowhere is that more important than in education, because Scotland needs the best skills if we are to compete with the world, to make things, to imagine things again, to create opportunities for our young people. But we saw the worrying trend against that in the PISA statistics out yesterday, and Michael Mara was quite right to bring our attention back to that. To hear, presiding officer, yesterday on national television, Stephen Flynn, the leader of the SNP at Westminster, tell Sky News that it wasn't the SNP's fault, was an insult. He actually sought to blame the decline in our international standards on a Liberal Democrat Labour government that left power 16 years ago. Our teachers and our pupils deserve so much better than denial and deflection. Now we have seen the worst ever results across reading, science and maths, with England performing better on every single measure. Performance has slipped under the SNP, and if Stephen Flynn can't accept that, then people will have no faith in the government's ability to get us back to where we could be. I can see that you want me to conclude, presiding officer. I have a lot more to say, not least on health, because when we don't have a healthy workforce, we cannot grow our economy. But I will rest on my remarks and move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. And I call Michael Mara. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Mara.
Thank you, presiding officer, and thank you to all members who have contributed to the debate this afternoon. Start in terms of Stuart McMillan's contribution. I very much agree in terms of the huge challenge, I think, that, and the wake-up call and the level of falling living standards across the whole of the UK that we are seeing, and what that should be telling us all about the direction that our economy has taken. And what we would entirely agree about just how poor the terrible Tory autumn statement was. And it comes from a government that thankfully is running out of time. They have left our economy in a parlous state, a stagnant state. And there is nothing that Jeremy Hunt said or did in the autumn statement that will have changed that. And they bear huge responsibility for our record fall in living standards and what is a woeful outlook for economic growth for this country. But in Scotland, we have been lumbered, I'm afraid, with two incompetent governments, and they are each more interested in stoking division and blaming each other rather than facing the consequences of their 16 and 13 years of decision-making, respectively. So it's on that basis that we will not be supporting the Tory amendment tonight, as we do not believe that either government is delivering, in the words of the amendment, the best outcomes for the Scottish economy. Because Alex Cole-Hamilton made some very good play in terms of the importance of economic growth and how vital that is to the future of our citizens and to our country, and yes, to our public finances. If we are to change the situation of the finances that we describe, not a moment, I'm just getting started, but thank you. We are to change the state of our public finances, we would want to see growth in our economy and making sure that we can raise the wages of Scots. Labour will also not be voting for the ALBA amendment tonight, which gets the party off to a flying start in the chamber. The Finance Committee has heard a considerable amount of evidence, as various members have said, on VAT assignment over the years. And at the most recent roundtable of 14th of November, witnesses and members were in broad agreement that VAT assignment was had significant practical barriers and with fairly limited benefits to Scotland. It's fair to say that, as my experience of ALBA on the internet, as limited as that is, they seem to be unencumbered by or troubled by evidence or reality. And I'm sorry that my address for Ash Regan was slightly dispiriting today. I have to say I thoroughly enjoyed her contribution, both of them, particularly her reflections on her time in government and the paucity of the record of our erstwhile colleagues. And, you know, she talked about the trap of this fiscal framework, designed perhaps by Michelle Thompson's zombies. And they had the common concern, I think, between the two of them about the... there's, of course, the nothing in that they had to say about that £11 billion economic cost of independence and the £14 billion fiscal cost that would be immediate. Yes.
Liz Smith.
I thank Mr Mara for giving way. Had he been in the Deputy First Minister's shoes, would the Labour Party have signed up to the fiscal framework?
Michael Mara.
I think it's a good question, because I think much of what was agreed, I think that we have supported, and we are certainly supportive of it in those broad terms. I don't believe that we would have liked to have come from this original starting point, which I think the Deputy First Minister found herself in, which was in a rushed decision to try and grasp onto the borrowing requirements that were there. Because I think that takes me, I think, to the points made by Kenneth Gibson, speaking as a convener of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. He had, I share his regrets, all of the committee's regrets about the process, and John Mason laid some of those out as well. But he doesn't really necessarily share my analysis as to why the agreement was so hastily reached. I don't really understand, in part, the dynamics in, I would say to Liz Smith, in striking an agreement where you have two signatories, and one of those signatures can be withheld and holding out, perhaps indefinitely, should the Deputy First Minister have chosen to do so, for a better deal. There was something in the motivation of the Deputy First Minister to get that deal done and quickly. And I believe in that respect that they've sacrificed the long-term prospects for their short-term political benefit. And I would say that within that, we do continue, and I think it's been a feature of the debate, shared those concerns by members across all parties about the lack of scrutiny, the public debate that would have actually assisted the government, frankly, I believe, in their job. I mean, there is welcome news from the courts this afternoon, with the Scottish Government defeated in their attempt to shut down freedom of information in this country. But as they also, as the Labour amendment states, we regret their approach that they've taken in this manner and around the fiscal framework. And it is an approach that's become far too common for the government. And it might be too technical, in the words according to the Deputy First Minister, but I don't think that should preclude proper public scrutiny. No matter what John Swinney might say or posture around my own contribution, luckily we have the official record that can show that his remarks certainly may have not been curious, but they were certainly spurious in that regard. But these are very touchy indeed, but these are very serious matters which we're speaking about today. They're very significant for the future of the country, very significant for our fiscal health in this country and the budget that we're going to see in a few weeks' time, where I'm sure the Deputy First Minister will be using these powers to their full extent.
Thank you, Ms. Amara. I now call Liz Smith up to 7 minutes. Ms. Smith.
Thank you. And can I begin again in summing up by thanking the officials behind the scenes, who I think really did a very difficult and complex job. And whilst I know there are issues about scrutiny, and I think these will be well made, I think the Finance Committee has already said a lot about some concerns over that scrutiny, and perhaps we have to look to rectify this when we come to the next fiscal framework. But I do think that the officials were working incredibly hard for a long period of time in coming to an agreement. And John Swinney is right to point to the word agreement, because that's what it has to be. And despite the fact that we have fundamental differences in our constitutional approaches, we obviously want different things. But this fiscal framework is about the current constitutional setup. And that's why it's important that it is an agreement and that both governments do the best on behalf of Scotland. Hence the reason why my amendment says what it does. Now, actually, I think this... Yes, of course.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Ms. Smith for giving way.
Can we have Mr. Swinney's microphone again, please?
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for giving way. On the substantive point that she makes about the welcome nature of a process of agreement, does she reflect that the experience that we've had since Brexit, where the Sewell Convention, where the UK government up until 2019 actually, indicated that they would not normally legislate against the consent of the Scottish Parliament, has now been breached on, I think, 9 occasions since Brexit. Does she think that is in the spirit of what we should reasonably expect in intergovernmental relations between the Scottish and the United Kingdom government and parliaments?
Liz Smith.
I think intergovernmental relations could be improved, and I think there are messages on both sides of that agreement as to why they could be improved. And that's an important message for this Parliament as well, just as much as it is for Westminster. Now, I actually think this debate was perhaps more interesting than some of us thought it was going to be. And in some cases, in fact, it was actually quite entertaining. Mr. Leonard likes to take the back seat at the top of the chamber there. And maybe a little bit of advice, perhaps if he moved a bit further to the front, he would be able to see the face of his front bench when he's making these points in his Arthur Scargill-esque terms. Because I don't think that Mr. Mara was in agreement with what Mr. Leonard was saying. I may be wrong, but I just get a hunch that there's no agreement there at all. Maybe a fiscal framework between the two of you might be a good thing. But I think that we've talked a little bit. My colleague Brian Whittle mentioned the word trust, and that's trust, not trust. Trust is important, very important. And it's important. Alex Cole-Hamilton raised this issue about trust between the Scottish Government and local government as well. And I think this Parliament has got a duty and a responsibility to think about how that trust can be built upon and enhanced, because clearly there are issues within local government just now, as Alex Cole-Hamilton quite rightly said, where that trust has been undermined. And if we're going to have better relationships between Scottish Government and the UK Government, then that has to be built on trust. Now, I want to say a little bit about the three Davids who put together the independent report, because not enough has been said about them. And it was an independent report, taking out the politics as much as was possible to do. And that's a difficult issue when it comes to the fiscal framework. But their report was extremely important in getting behind the politics. And in their executive summary, they said something very interesting, that both governments have a duty to set out transparently the reliability for this fiscal framework and the decisions that it has to make. And I think that's important, because they were doing their level best in very difficult circumstances and very complex formula to be able to do that. And I think they deserve a great praise. Certainly every attention given to detail when it came to the Finance Committee. I can't thank them enough, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of my colleagues in the Finance Committee for just how much we owe a debt to them for making something that is more intelligible than many people think the fiscal framework is. Now, Mr McKee made some interesting points in his speech, and Mr McKee, when he was a minister, was listening to business. And I'm quite sure that when that business community is speaking to Mr McKee just now, they will be putting to Mr McKee quite a lot of points about taxation, which he raised in his speech. And I can put a lot of money on the fact that the business community is telling Mr McKee that the last thing that business wants is a high-tax Scottish economy, where the people who are hopefully coming to work and live and invest here feel slightly aggrieved about that. That's the last thing that Scotland needs. So can I finish, Deputy Presiding Officer, on the fact that this fiscal framework is so important for this Parliament, it's so important for the Scottish economy, and I think putting the constitutional politics aside, which is very difficult, but it really matters that we look at it from as objective an analysis that we can, and we take on board the advice that is given to us from independent economists and the academics on whom we rely so much for the information, and on the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So can I say at the end that I think the debate is very important. I think it's definitely to be continued. But once again, thank you to those who were involved in signing the agreement, and all those who worked behind the scenes, because it really means an awful lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now invite the Minister to wind up the debate. Up to 9 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by joining the Deputy First Minister and colleagues from around the Chamber in paying tribute and expressing my thanks to both Scottish Government and UK Government officials for their work in ensuring that we have reached this agreement in this revised fiscal framework. And indeed, can I join Liz Smith, and I'm sure others would want to join me as well, in thanking the authors of the independent report. And I would also want to pay tribute to the work of the Deputy First Minister in securing this deal, and also pay tribute to John Swinney in his work in progressing this deal, and indeed the original fiscal framework, along with my colleague Kate Forbes when she had this particular responsibility. John Swinney's contribution served as a timely reminder for just how hard fought and how hard gained these powers are that we now enjoy. And that is something we should always bear in mind. Even when we're having a debate like this, which at times could perhaps be dry and technical, it is of fundamental importance to the people of Scotland, because it ultimately dictates the revenue we have at our disposal to fund public services upon which we all depend. But these powers did not arise by themselves. They are the result of hard negotiation, and they're also the result of clear views expressed by the Scottish people. Just as constitutional change in previous decades, whether that be Kilbrandon, the Scotland Act of the 70s, or indeed the Constitutional Convention of the 80s, followed on from or coincided with significant SNP advances, so the further devolution we have seen come to this Parliament followed on from the SNP's victory in 2007. And the powers that we are debating primarily today are a direct consequence of so many people choosing to vote for independence only 10 years ago in the independence referendum. Now, we are, of course, operating in, or in taking forward the review of the fiscal framework, we're operating within a number of contexts. I have heard some colleagues ask why more could not have been achieved. It is a fair question to ask, but at times it ignores the reality that we are two partners within a negotiation, and we are ultimately limited by how much the UK Government wishes to concede. And we have sought to engage in these negotiations in a mature way to go and deliver the best outcome, and in doing so have not sought to make the perfect the enemy of the good. Yes.
Liz Smith.
I'm grateful to the Minister giving way. Does he accept, however, that the UK Government did listen to the requests of the Scottish Government when it came to inflation-proofing the change and to ensuring that there was greater flexibility on the borrowing powers that you have and to ensuring that it was more responsive to exogenous shocks? That was the difference between the 2016 and the 2023 fiscal framework.
Minister.
As we have recognised, we recognise this as significant progress. I pay tribute to the UK Government officials and indeed to the former Chief Secretary of the Treasury. It is, of course, not all that we would want, but it does respond to some of our concerns, and I know that it responds to some of the concerns that Parliament has expressed as well. We are also operating within the context of the Smith Commission principles. These principles are cross-party in origin. I note the comments that Liz Smith made in her remarks, and of course Government would listen with interest to any further considerations that members or indeed any committees of this Parliament may have with regards to the Smith principles going forward. The final point I want to speak about in terms of context is the fiscal context that we're operating in, because while we may discuss the fiscal framework in abstract terms, in reality this is about how resources are allocated, and ultimately any framework in terms of its outputs is only going to be good as its inputs. And the situation we do find ourselves in, as the Scottish Government motion makes clear, is grave. We face the most profound set of fiscal challenges, I think, that any government has experienced under devolution. And this is not unique to Scotland. We know that the situation in Wales is just as grave. In October, the Welsh Government set out that they needed to find £600 million in savings before the end of the financial year. Now, accounting for differences in size of our budget, that would be the equivalent of over £1 billion in Scotland. In terms of the context we have moving into the next financial year, the UK Government have not inflation-proofed their capital budget, which is forecast to result in a 9.8% real-terms cut in our UK capital funding over the medium term between 23-24 and 27-28. And finally, on resource, at the autumn statement, the UK Government delivered real-term cuts to NHS England and real-term cuts to justice as well. This presents us with a grave set of choices, and this is the context in which we find ourselves as we sit less than 2 weeks out from the budget. Now, I do want to recognise that there has been a constructive tone to much of this debate, and indeed Liz Smith touched on the need to be a sense of a duty for Scotland to get the best deal, and I think collectively a duty on this Parliament. And I want to commend the work of the Finance and Public Administration Committee in its scrutiny of the fiscal framework, and indeed the work of its predecessor committee, of which I was a member in the last session. I think it is incumbent upon both the Scottish Government and indeed the UK Government to reflect on very carefully the considerations put forward by the Finance Committee across a range of issues, and particularly on the matter of VAT assignment, which I know a number of members have touched on. Now, of course, we will continue to engage constructively with the UK Government ahead of the next fiscal framework review. That, as has been stated out, it would be estimated to take place in 5 years, not once in any particular session. But I recognise that members will, of course, have an interest in how the agreements that we have reached in this new fiscal framework review are implemented. And, of course, further information will be provided as part of the budget process. Yes, certainly.
John Mason.
I thank the Minister for giving way. Is it his understanding that if there was a change of government at Westminster, that could trigger another look at the fiscal framework?
Minister.
Well, I would certainly hope so. I would certainly hope that a change of administration at Westminster would afford an opportunity for a refreshed approach. I do not know if the Labour Party have updated their position
My understanding from Gordon Brown's commission, which I believe forms the basis for Labour's constitutional offering, at page 110 states that a consultation should be held over uprating Scottish capital borrowing ceilings. Now, that, of course, has now been superseded by the fiscal framework, so I would hope that any incoming Labour government, should that be the outcome of the election, would take a more ambitious approach, reflecting on many of the contributions that have been made today. Indeed, reflecting on perhaps some of the contributions from Labour member Richard Leonard, who I'm sure Mr Mara on the front bench listened to very carefully and has been taking copious notes to inform Labour's constitutional position going forward. But I would note on Labour's point, and this was something that Stuart McMillan set out in some detail, and that was highlighting the comments of Keir Starmer. We are facing austerity. It is austerity redux, but it is in the context now of some 13 years of austerity, economic mismanagement from the UK government, and general political and economic chaos. What the UK government have put forward cannot stand. It must be revisited. But what we have heard so far is not just obstinance from the UK government, but an embrace of that fiscal approach from the Labour Party as well. Yeah. So what the UK is facing and what Scotland is facing through no choice of itself is austerity for the rest of this decade. And while this fiscal framework represents an improvement upon our current fiscal arrangements, if we truly want to be able to unleash the potential of the Scottish people, if we want to have an economy that can compete with our competitors in Ireland and Norway and in Denmark and other similarly small, medium economies, then the only way we are going to do that is not through mitigation, not through a halfway house of a fiscal framework and devolution, but taking on the full powers of an independent nation.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on fiscal framework review. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. The next item of business is consideration of a business motion 11560 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out our business programme, and I invite George Adam to move such a motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you. No member is asked to speak against the motion. The question is that motion 11560 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Parliament is agreed. The next item of business is consideration of five Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 11561 to 11563 on approval of SSIs, and 11564 and 11565 on designation of a lead committee. Minister.
All moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And the question on these motions will be put at decision time, at which we now arrive, and there are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. I'd remind the Chamber that the amendment in the name of Liz, if the amendment in the name of Liz Smith is agreed, the amendments in the name of Michael Mara and Ash Regan will fall. The first question is that amendment 11546.4 in the name of Liz Smith, which seeks to amend motion 11546 in the name of Shona Robison on a fiscal framework review, be agreed. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the voting system.